Special learning this morning. This today is the Yahrzeit of one of my biggest inspirations in Breslov. Today's the Yahrzeit of, it was a big tzaddik. It's funny, when you talk, when you go to Breslov, you could start saying he was a big tzaddik. Because the Chabad could be like, this guy was a grace of Beinoni. But this Breslover was a big tzaddik. His name, I'm sure you've heard me mention his name before. His name was Reb Levi Yitzchok Bender. This is a picture of him in the back over here. Reb Levi Yitzchok Bender was the leading figure in Breslov here in Eretz Yisrael. He passed away in 1989. He's one of the few that like made Aliyah from Uman, like from back then. Reb Yitzchok Bender, known by all of, like today, it's so many different groups. You have no idea who's on whose team anymore. Unfortunately, even within Breslov, you have no idea who's who anymore. Besides, like maybe Rav Yaakov Meir Shechter is like the only one from the old school that's kind of like, one of the leading figures, but he was Rav Yaakov Meir Shechter's Rebbe, meaning Rav Levi Yitzchok Bender was huge. He was a real simple Oved Hashem with every ounce of energy he had. There's countless stories about him. The one that I heard last night was that when people came to pay Shiva call when he passed away, so Rav Yaakov Meir Shechter was sitting there in the room and he said to people, he's like, you want to know who Rav Levi Yitzchok was? He was such a tzaddik. He ate, he drank, he slept, but every single second was calculated. He was a tzaddik, not because he abstained from everything, but because every second of his life was a cheshbon, was calculated. And there was this video clip going around of him in the middle of a farbringen, like just looking at the way he looked at his watch. It's amazing how you could learn for hours from Sfarim, and he hopefully goes inside you, and then you see the ma'aseh, the action of a tzaddik, with your own eyes, and sometimes that affects you so much deeper. Like I once saw a tzaddik the way he drank tea, mamash, the way he drank tea, I don't know what it aroused within me, a ratzon to be a real Oved Hashem, more than like learning for 15 hours. It's like this sometimes. And he was like this, he was very much like this. And he was the leading figure amongst the Breslover Hasidim. And like I said, I think he was born in 1907, and he passed away in 1989. Okay, so let's see if I have any more news. Yeah.
So everybody wants to give up their jackets.
So Dick, look
you
at
gotta
this.
Go back to it.
Amazing.
It's
yeah?
Beautiful.
It was beautiful?
Yeah.
You see? Probably learned so much from just from looking at that. Anyway, this is a sefer called Diburei Emunah. Now this is like Sichot, Reb Levi Yitzchak Bender, just talking Emunah. And the way he just speaks Emunah, he was known of just like, not like he's a Magid Shir, but he was like the one that would give over Sichot and be like, let's just talk about what life's really about and the stuff we all want, but let's speak about it with utmost dveikus to Rabbeinu, Rabbi Nachman, Schus HaGalino. Obviously, when he says Rabbeinu Zal, that's what he's referring to over here. So I thought it'd be beautiful to get some chizuk and emunah today, dafka on his yortzei Reb Levi Yitzchak Bender, Schus Yagin Aleinu, and the learning, we continue to learn for the Refuah Shleima of Yakir Ephraim ben Rachel Dvorah. So as you see over here, in the first page, Tzadik Vav Drachea Dar Chinoam. This is from Chayei Moharan. It's the beginning of the quote is Chayei Moharan. That's like Rabbi Nachman's biography. It's a story, a book about his life. Shamanu pa'am achat mesichotav hakdoshot she'amar b'piv hakadosh. We once heard Rabbi Nachman conversing with someone. He said, she'avoda hagdola shebagdolot ba'avodat Hashem, the greatest avoda in the avodas Hashem, kala yoter, kala biyoter la'asot Esek Kinyan Parnasah, is easier to do than the hardest thing in making yourself a Parnasah. Why? Shematrichin atzman bishvil Parnasah ve'iskei olam hazeh. You see people going through such strengths and measures for Parnasah in this world. Ki alo anu roim kama yegiot yega ha'adam bishvil inso al eze yerid ve'yom adeshuka. שתכף במוצאי שבס צריך לטרוח ולחפש אחר העגלה, ונחפז מאוד לטעון סחורתו על העגלה, ביגיעה גדולה, ואחר כך צריך לנסוע כל הלילה, ולנדוד שינה מעיניו ומשבר כל גופו, מחמד שצריך להישב על עגלה תאונה, ושאר תרחות והגיעות כיוצא בהן כידוע לעולם, ואחר כך צריך לעמוד כל יום על רגליו, ובפרט בימות הקור והעצום. What does he say? Look what a person does in order to make parnasa. He'll do anything. He'll work so hard. He'll head out the second after Shabbos all night. If tomorrow, I guess Sunday was the Yom HaYerid, it was the market day, right? So these each schlep, and it doesn't matter how many hours he has to stand, but he knows he's doing it because this will hopefully bring in parnasa. Hopefully he'll sell something. Hopefully there'll be the beginning of some kind of a income bringing inside. But look what a person would do for it. וכל אלו התרחות והיגיעות הכבדות הקשות הוא מטריח עצמו על ספק. And he does all this stuff, not sure if he's gonna bring in, you know, if he's gonna drive in the goods or not. He's not sure he's gonna do it, right? כי ספק אם ירוויח איזה רווח קטן או אולי יאבד גם ההוצאות. Avi, can you pass me that little stander right next to him? Is that okay, though?
Of course.
Thank you. It's fun. It's easier for me.
You're welcome
to do anything about that. Thank you. Thank you so much. It's all suffix. Look how much effort you put into a suffix. Crazy. Nimtza she'al iskei parnasat ha'olam hazeh. We see that when it comes to parnasa in this world, matrichin atzmam kol kach b'igiyot ka'ele al safek revach katan. It's not so much anymore these days, right? Because most of us these days, I'm not saying about everybody, but most of us these days, we do jobs that we know are guaranteed to bring us income, right? Like I'm not going to go somewhere, do a job, and with you it's a little bit tricky.
I'm thinking anybody who owns a business, there is always that suffix.
Anybody who's a CEO.
If you're an employee,
right.
There's a chance you get fired, but as long
right.
as you get fired, you're
but
making
I,
your
But meaning, I'll work hard because I know, unless something crazy happens, that you know, I'm getting a paycheck. And if I don't know I'm getting a paycheck, I probably won't work that hard as an employee. But I guess back then, but meaning like the lifestyle of a marketplace of a Yerid, I mean, that was the way, like that shook, the way people would work in a shook, that was just the, you know.
Put out your
jersey. Yeah.
Sounds about.
Right today.
Yeah. That's what I have.
Yeah, serious. working.
Everybody here who works is shaking their head.
Because everyone's a CEO here, huh?
There's a lot of...
only one CEO.
Tom. Okay.
Family business. He's the CEO.
You're the CEO of our family business. Are you firing any of us anytime soon? Are we fired? We're in.
Ain't no
suffix
in the family business.
Ain't no suffix in the family business. אוקיי, אז נמצא שעל יסקי פרנסת העולם הזה מטריחין עצמן כל כך בגיעות כאלה, על ספק רווח קטן. והעבודה הגדולה שבגדולות, ברוחני עשי התפילה, right? The greatest עבודה in רוחני is davening, ואף על פי כן, כשעומדים להתפלל, מתפלים וגומרים התפילה. When it comes to davening, where there's no suffix, that I just, you know, I don't put that much effort into it. When it comes to the hard business stuff that maybe would, maybe won't, that I'll put everything into it. But davening, which is no sfeikas, say there, I'll go to shul. So look how now that's from Rabbi Nachman. Now look over here.
But it's not so objectively. It's not so crazy. People want to survive. I mean, there's a certain line where we cross over and we're doing it beyond survival. But I think part of the basic instinct is we do want to survive. And we feel like if we didn't daven, we don't have that thing, oh, if I don't daven, I'm not going to be able to survive.
Right. Right. See, we don't see what's what.
We don't see it. It's like,
but the whole point is that you'll go...
Absolutely.
He answered himself. Halfway through, he answered himself. I don't even have to answer. Okay. I love you, Gunnar. B'Sefer Amidot, Tshuva Yutet Katav Rabbeinu. Rabbi Nachman wrote like this in Sefer Amidot. Yesh lehakel ofen ha-tshuva al ha-chot'im. This is very interesting. יש להקל אופן התשובה על החוטין. רבי נחמן's answer was, don't be too hard on explaining to sinners how to do תשובה. Don't be too heavy on them. כלומר, לא להכביד יותר מדי על אלו הרוצים לחזור בתשובה. Don't be too heavy on those that actually want to do תשובה. It's like you know in the Olam HaEmes, oh, you sinned and you mechal at Shabbos. Well, according to the Dinei Shemayim, that basically means that you're kares, right? So if you want to do tshuva on a kares, what does that probably mean if you want to be really real? I don't know. Think of the most heaviest load of tshuva a person has to do, right? For these stuff. And you have people, look, Yossi is a chassid, Yossi has a shit, Yossi, you know. Has one of his rabbeim is like the guy that like tells you to your face he's gonna tell you know and it's a very heavy deal and for his neshama he feels like he needs to get completely whipped and heavy loads of tshuva. But Rabbi Nachman's etza was someone that wants to come and do tshuva. That's why he's the rebbe of this generation, because it's not gonna work for this generation to come and tell sinners what you know to drop on them the heaviest load of what they have, what kind of tshuva they have to do. Rabbi Nachman's etza was לא להכביד יותר מדי על אלו הרוצים לעשות תשובה. Meaning, don't drop it all at once. Don't make it so heavy on them and bring it down on them so hard and heavy. בשבחי הבעל שם טוב מובא סיפור. This is Reb Levi Yitzchak talking. Story about the בעל שם טוב, שהבעל שם טוב גער ברבי מיכל מזלצ'וב. You ever hear of Rabbi Mechel of Zlotchov? That's actually, we found out earlier this year, I told you, that's my wife's great-great-grandfather, directly, from her mother's side. Reb Mechel is Lotchever. You must have heard me tell the story about the niggun of the Rebbe, that he sang at Chalashudis, that he had to have a designated non-singer to make sure that he wouldn't be consumed by the niggun, and someone had to like not sing to wake people out of the coma of the niggun. Reb Mechel is Lotchever. A lot of stories about him. Reb Yechiel Mechel is Lotchever. So it says over here that the story of Baal Shem Tov Ga'ar b'Rebbe Mechel Mizlotchev, he got angry at him, but not just angry, he mamish gave it to him. Why? שנתן לאחד שנחשב בעבירה בשוגג תשובה קשה ביותר שלא היה יכול לעמוד בה. He got so angry at this Reb Mechel of Zlotchev because he prescribed a very heavy etza of tshuva for someone that did nevera by accident. And Baal Shem Tov got very mad at him. What the story is, it's a whole, you see in small print, I'll just tell it to you very fast, you don't have to see inside, that one time it happened that someone was Mechal Shabbos by accident, so he came to the Mechal Zlotchov and asked him for a tikkun, what he should be doing for this Chil Shabbos, and Rav Mechal Zlotchov gave him a prescription of heavy tshuva, based on, you know, some of the svarim, a lot of fasting, rolling around in snow, pains, afflictions, all this crazy stuff. Siddhi Ashkenaz. It's a known thing. That's what they would be doing. And but he started feeling like there's no way in the world he could actually do this. He started doing it, but he felt so downhearted, and he felt like there's no chance for him to actually do tshuva. And then the Baal Shem Tov eventually came to that city, and this Yid went to him for Shabbos, and he was basically asking him, do you have any like lower prescription of tshuva for me to do?
Second
for this?
Opinion.
Yeah, second opinion. So the Baal Shem Tov said to him, yeah, for sure, listen, take one box of candles, or one liter of oil, right, and light a bunch of candles in Shul, Chovet Shabbos Kodesh, that'll be your tikkun. He's like, what?
My new doctor.
Right. So he's standing there. He's like, what is this going to help me regarding this Shabbos? So Baal Shem Tov asked him, why are you so shocked about my prescription, right? So he said to him, listen, this Reb Mechel Zlotchev, he's like, you're a student. He told me to do this crazy thing that I can't even do. So Baal Shem Tov says, listen, I'm telling you, do it. This is what you should be doing. This is your full tshuva, right? So this Yid leaves dancing away from the Baal Shem Tov. He's so happy, right? So right after he came to take these candles to bring them to the shul and to light them, he came to the shul and he didn't find the shamus. So he just hung the candles on some kind of a candelabra there, and he left. Suddenly a dog came and ate the wax, ate the with the candles, you know, the candles, which made him feel so bad, and he felt just more and more worse now. He went right away to the Baal Shem Tov and told him how sad he is because his nedava went to a dog instead of a shul. So the Baal Shem Tov said, come back again, bring this again, these candles. And this problem, this time I promise you, the caliph won't eat this. So the Baal Shem Tov asked him, and by the way, tell Rabbi Mechel Zlotchev, the first doctor, tell him I want to see him. So Rabbi Mechel Zlotchev comes to him, and but on his way there, there was some kind of a problem with this wagon that Reb Mechel Zlotchev ended up having to walk the last chunk of the journey, and he has to end up walking on Shabbos to get to the Baal Shem Tov. And while the Baal Shem Tov was ready after davening, which meant approximately 4 to 5 hours into Shabbos, right? The Baal Shem Tov was ready after davening, about to do Kiddush, right? It's not like, you know, oh, Shabbos,
Like 1 a.m.
Right, it's not like 7:30 Friday night. It's like 1 a.m. he gets to the Baal Shem Tov.
He's going to that shul that we visited.
Ah, give up. Yeah, he's going to that shul. There's a Hashem that our wives will be in. There's a Hashem being in. So the Baal Shem Tov said to him, Nul Michele, now you'll know how to do a... Now you'll know how to do a tikkun for someone that does something by accident. You, a person that never tasted a taste of sin your whole life, how would you know and feel the pain of a yid that fails? God forbid, an avera. How can you give him the tikkunim, the tshuvas, that you were giving him before? You know how much brokenheartedness, now you know how much brokenheartedness this yid had.
Because he had to walk.
Because for him, that was like eating a pig.
Yeah.
So the Baal Shem Tov was saying to him, you know?
Now you go to tshuva.
Now you'll know how to talk to someone that's so brokenhearted. Over doing something b'shogeg, just like you, b'shogeg, your agala broke down. It wasn't amazing. But look at the Baal Shem Tov. What did he want to tell him? He's like, listen, what's this chiddush of chassidus? What is this whole thing? We're talking to the hearts of people. People are broken. The prescriptions of tshuva from days of, you know, it's not for our days anymore. And that's what the Baal Shem Tov was giving him tshuva, and Rabbi Nachman was very big on this himself. He's like, don't make it too hard on people. They feel bad enough. People's hearts are big enough these days. They feel bad enough about the avers they did. You telling a guy he has to go and run around, roll around naked in this freezing snow in the Russian winter, and fast for 84 days straight. That's gonna.
This is why you've told us the stories of the Rebbeim. Yeshua and I were talking about today, who take it on them why they're hearing these avers that are coming to them. It's not just.
They're
so that
the
they
guy,
could do
right.
A tikkun on it, but it's that whatever that they give
they
out as a prescription,
yeah.
That they're connected to say, like,
I'm connected to this. This has to do with me. Baal Shem Tov is saying to Reb Mechel Zlotchev, you want to give someone a tikkun of tshuva like this? Are you connected to it? Do you feel this pain? You have to feel this pain. And then if you felt this pain, there's no way you'd come to that conclusion to give that guy the Eitzah such a harsh tshuva, harsh tikkun. It's pretty beautiful, actually, when you look. It's just beautiful. Okay, so let's now look at the last, on page Tzadik Zayin, you have the thing, look at the last line in the story. U'mesayem ha-shivchei ba'al Shem Tov, nishma mizeh she'ikar ha-tshuva hu shvirat ha-lev v'charata, ve'lo ha-sigufim. So Ba'al Shem Tov says, we see from here that the real core of tshuva is the heartbrokenness and the regret, and not the afflictions. But it probably was until then, for many, many years, that if you felt really, really bad and heartbroken, you didn't really feel like you did anything. You didn't mshayach that to part of your tshuva at all. And the Baal Shem Tov is coming and saying, do you realize that feeling so horrible with real charata, real sincere regret, is an essential core piece of your tshuva?
Could it be that there was a time when people would be over an avera, but and they know they're over the avera, but it doesn't really break their heart, so they have to afflict themselves
could
to
be.
Get to a place of brokenheartedness?
Could be. Chol meod liot. And the Baal Shem Tov was saying, okay, but now we're in a door, a different door. This is how people are feeling. Okay. Now, achen. Da'ato shel Rabbeinu lo nocha haita me'arichat tzomot v'taniyot levad ad shebitel legamre et avodat ha'taniyot. Rabbi Nachman used to fast from Shabbos to Shabbos, consecutively, a lot. Not when he was 65, because he never lived to 65. He lived until the age of 38. So when he was younger, when we say younger, that means teenager, right, or 20s, he would do this a lot. But later in life, Rabbi Nachman said, had I known the power of his motives, had I known how potent it is, I would have never gone through all those pains and afflictions that I took upon myself. I would have never done that stuff. So Rabbi Nachman completely dropped all that avoda of the pain and the affliction. And he just stopped it. But he would do what the early Kabbalists would do, what's called Gilgulei Sheleg. One morning in Amiftar, my first year, second year here, it came down hard. The snow came down hard. And Amiftar, the yeshiva is much higher than, you know, here. So when it came down, did anyone ever here experience a heavy snow? Like a real heavy snow in a frat?
Yeah.
Oh, we, right.
The year I came.
Nachon, about 5 years ago we had Friday night. Remember that? That was amazing. So I'm talking much more than that. There was one year about 15 years ago. And one guy, he was so excited. I'm like, why are you so excited? You grew up in snow. Mele, me, LA boy. I remember the first time I saw snow, I was like 16 or 17. I was so excited. I'm like, why are you so excited? You grew up in upstate New York. He's like, oh, you don't know how many Averas have waited for this. I'm like, what are you talking about? Strips naked and starts rolling. It's freezing outside. He starts rolling around in the snow. And he's banging his head in the snow and, you know, it's not exactly a guy you want to do a mashadah for your daughter with, because it's not working with a full cup. But I remember seeing a person do Gilgulei Sheleg, and I'm thinking, I'm like, wow, that was an Efrat, right? Can you imagine doing this in Kiev in 1820?
He's guaranteed to get sick afterward too.
Then go for a dip in the river.
Step. Right.
How much be doing to it?
Yeah.
Right.
he got to the equivalent of it in that river.
It's true. Gilgul, so look at the second line here on the bottom. Gilgul sheleg v'sigufim gamkem einam avureinu. This is Reb Levi Yitzchak Ben Nissim. This is not for us. It's kind of elamai. But what is for us? Ptach picha. Open your mouth. V'daber diburim la'Hashem yitbarach. Speak to Hashem. V'im tiskeh v'daber b'sha'at et ratzon shel chatzot. If you merit to get up for chatzot and do this in chatzot, v'day adif u'me'ule b'yoter. Now you're thinking, oh, thank God he said that, right? Because that's so much easier now, right? Wrong. That's the trick. That's what's crazy. To roll around naked in the freezing snow is not nearly as hard to commit to talking to Hashem and pouring out your heart. That's the trick here. People always say, oh, open tests, those exams, you know, we're always... I remember in Smicha when we had some tests that were open books, and some tests were like oral exams where you walk into the rabbi, terrified he'd ask you a question, right? Oh, if I have a sefer that's like open book exam, that's much easier. Lahefech, those were actually much harder. It's very tricky. But he's saying over here, and he's going to say the next line, Ach avodah zo, shel tfilah v'sicha, v'amirat diburim lifnei Hashem yitbarach. Next page. Hanir'et lichora pshuta v'kala. It seems so easy. Sorry about the print on the next page. I know what happened. It seems so easy. That seems so... Thank God that doctor gave me that prescription, right? Af hi nofelet b'chvidut al adam. That falls on you so heavy. And you get this sense of heaviness when you don't do it. And suddenly you're like, wait a second, I thought this was going to be so much easier. I know. It doesn't happen like that at all. Umadua, why is it? Ech ze mistadel? How could it be that something that seems like it'd be so much easier, it feels so much harder? Ki heyot shemekor, this is Rabbi Levi Yitzchak Ben Yehuda, what he's saying. Since the makor of the Eitzah is from Rabbeinu, the Tzaddik Emes, azai hi nichneset amok b'shoresh tikkun nefesh adam, lachen hi kasha biyoteh. The more that something is really cleansing and fixing your shoresh neshama, even if it seems like it's an easy thing, it becomes much, much more difficult to implement. Anyone following me?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anyone see this in their own life? Mm-hmm. It's not the crazy thing. And you're wondering, you're like, how in the world could it be that I did not take this on? This is the easy medicine. So he's saying over here, because when we're talking about root work, the tzaddikim, the tzaddik, like and he's speaking about Rabbi Nachman of Breslov, the medicines he's prescribing, they're root canals. They're not just nice outside, you know, massage. They're root canals. It's tipul shoresh. And the more that something is dealing with the root work, the more that it seems, it becomes on you so much heavier, and you yourself can't explain to yourself, why is it so crazy to refrain from this or to do whatever I'm supposed to be doing? Remember, we have 613 mitzvahs. How many did Adam HaRishon have? One. Couldn't do it. Why? Because Hashem telling him don't eat from that tree had to do with the root of his soul. And when we learn this from the first sin, when something has to do with the root of our neshamas, it becomes so much more difficult. We're so good in all those other cute little things we do. But when it comes to the root of our souls, these things seem like they're heavy, they come on so heavy. And you're sitting wondering, wait a second, all I gotta do is open my heart and speak to Hashem? That's the medicine? Yeah, so why didn't I do it? So everyone thinks, oh, I'll become a breast liver. Their sheet does very easy. They go to the woods and talk to Hashem every day. Do you know that's harder to do than fasting from week to week? On a certain level, it's harder to do this. There's only one person in this whole community I know that has taken on his Boderus every single day for an hour. Miriam Sasson. It's the only person I know here. It's the hardest thing in the world. It's the hardest thing in the world. Wow, that's hard? What a treat that is. Nah. It's the hardest thing in the world because it has to do with the core of your soul. So I believe, that's why I believe Yitzchak Bender is speaking to us on this level. Ki habal davar, third line, habal davar, the baal davar, we saw this language by Rabbi Yaakov Meir Shech. Huh? What's the baal davar? If Shlomo would call this brother other side. Right? Brother other side. Lo ma'afsher lekayem zot. Satan comes and he won't let you do this. Why? Because he knows if you go there, you do this root work, he's done. You beat him. So he'll do everything he can to make the things that seem the easiest, the hardest. B'yod'o shekach efshar la'akor oto min ha'shoresh. The Baal Davar knows that if this yid goes and listens to this medicine from the Tzaddik Emes, he will uproot the Satan from its source. Lachen tzarich la'avoda v'yitiyagut rabba. And therefore you need so much heavy, heavy work to go and attack this on a very deep level. So what we're seeing over here is something very interesting. It'd be interesting to point out in our own life these inyanim, right? Catch yourself. What seems to you to be a very heavy thing in Avodas Hashem? And what seems to be like a simple thing? And what do you end up doing more? what do you usually end up being able to achieve more? What seems to you like a hard thing, or what seems to you like an easy thing? What do you guys think? You have to think about this. You have to go into your hearts and see, like, in your cheshbon of avodas Hashem, what seems like harder? Listen, taking on a masechta and finishing it. What does that seem like?
Seems hard.
Seems hard. It's very easy. We just do it. It's just like a commitment thing. Every day right now, I want us all right now to take on for ourselves, every day till Sunday, 15 minutes. So that's an accumulation of, how long is that? It's Thursday, Friday, Shabbat, Sunday. Dedicate an hour from the next 96 hours of pouring out your heart to Hashem. I'm already cracking up. How could that be? Because we're dealing with root work. Rabbi Levi Yitzchak believed that the Eitz of the Tzaddik is root work, and when it's root work, you can't even explain it to yourself, but it's so much more difficult. It's so much harder and more intense. Rabbeinu Omer, look in the bottom over here. Rabbeinu Omer, Rabbi Nachman says in Likutei Maharan, "I efshar lavo le'amet." Can't come to truth. Shali deze ba'im le'emunah, which truth leads you to emunah. Ki arei emunah hi al yedei emet, because emunah is through the aspect of truth, like it's brought from the Zohar Kadosh. He said the only way you come to emet, ela al yedei hitkavut le'tzadikim. We should be privileged to this. It's something that's so lacking in the more modern Orthodox circles that we've been raised in and live in. It's very, very painful to see. He's saying the only way to come to Emet is by drawing near, being close to tzaddikim, having a tzaddik in your life, v'yelech b'derech atzatam, and to listen to the etzot of the tzaddikim. V'al yedei shemekabel mehem atzatam, and when you receive from them the Eitza, nechkak bo emet. Emet becomes engraved within you. Those of you that do have a tzaddik in your life, and I know some of you do, and I know the tzaddikim that some of you are connected to, you see when you receive an Eitza from the tzaddik, emes becomes engraved into you. You know, when we're on the trips in the Ukraine, half the time, I think I shared this with you, when I'm listening to something, it's one track. It's a track from Karduner that whenever he's here, I ask him to sing it. I felt like Lahavdil Elef Alfei Avdolos, what I said before about Marley, about feeling like, oh, his songs were for me. Chas v'shalom. I feel like this nigun from Karduner was for me. It's the only thing I listen to when we're traveling from tzaddik to tzaddik. Do you know what song I'm talking about? Da ki ika hagalu. Eino ela bishvil chesron emuna ki ikar hageula talui ba'emuna. And then he goes, "Eifshar lavo le'emuna ela al yedei hitkarvut la'tzadikim sheholchim ba'atzatam." When you go in their etzah, azay nechkak banu emet. Then MS becomes engraved in us. Gale lanu malkeinu et ha-tzadikim ha-amitim. Reveal to us. If that's the truth, that when I take the Eitz of the Tzadik, it becomes ingrained in me, then Rebbeinu Shleilam, gale lanu, reveal to us who the tzadikim ha-amitim are, v'nelech be'or ha-tzatam, and will walk the streets of this world and the paths of our heart in the light of their Eitzah. That's the only song. When we go to these, when we go on these trips, Amamish, that's the, I'm looking forward to just having that on repeat. It's over and over and over again. So this is, comes from here, from these words in the Minachman. Klomar, fourth line, She'ikar avodat ha'emet, hilalechet baderech atzatam shel tzadikei ha'emet. Is just to walk with the Eitzah of the Tzaddik Emes. Right? Now jump to the bottom. Ach derech ha-baal davar hu. But the way that the Baal Davar works, the Sitra Achra works, shedavka biglal she'atzat tzaddikim hi derech emet. Dafka because the Eitzah of the Tzaddikim is the derech of emet, This is what God desires. Because God obviously desires the truth. The Eitzah Hara comes and tells you this thing which seems so simple. Doesn't this feel like a heavy load? Doesn't this feel like such a burden? It's like right now each of us started thinking, where am I going to find those 15 minutes? To do what? To learn Rabina and Rav Ashi? To finish Mishnayos? To run around? To hike a mountain? To sit and talk to Hashem? He makes that seem like it's the hardest thing in the world, the Satan. He makes it seem, the Satan makes it seem, that every Eitzah, just an advice that a Tzaddik gives you, is the heaviest burden in the world. What does the Baal Davar make it sound like? That who's making it hard for you? That the Tzaddik is making life hard for you. He's calling it out, spade for spade here, the Rebbe Yitzchak Bender. He's saying not only is the Satan make it seem that the Eitzah of the Tzaddik is a heavy load, were you directing your frustration afterwards? I can't believe I went to that Rav. I can't believe I went to that Tzaddik. What did he tell you to do? He told you to get rid of your half of your house? No, he just told me I have to do that little thing. That's what he told you to do? And you're holding him, you have such resentment towards him? Who is the master of that piece of art? That is the other side. That's the Sitra Achra.
What if it's the side that gave you the first verse, the Fletcher verse?
Then he'd be admonished by the Baal Shem Tov. Then you're not a brassler.
Then you have a time to have that.
No, that's why he opened up this whole thing saying, Rabbi Nachman's Eitzah is when it comes to prescriptions, don't be too heavy on the person. If the dosage you're getting is a heavy dosage,
it's not for you.
He's saying that's not our derech of Breslov. Now some people were sitting here and be like, sorry, that's why I don't connect. Okay, that's your deal.
I need
to get whipped.
Right.
Say it. We can't convince you that like this isn't for you, but it seems to be that Rabbi Nachman is the Rebbe of this generation because of this exact. One of the main reasons.
That you just sang was about revealing the tzaddik, but that could mean reveal the tzaddik to me. Reveal to me who my tzaddik is. Meaning, it might be that somebody says like this just isn't for me. I need it heavier. Which means
I think Karduna would have a hard time that you used his nigun to find a Rebbe that has nothing to do with Rabbi Nachman. I hear what you're saying. But I think when I hear Yosef singing Galel Lanu, Tzadik Amiti, meaning let me find the Tzadik whose prescription is not a heavy load, but it's Emes Lamito, just reveal that to me. I'm usually looking for a complete spiritual facelift. Like that's what I think is the right thing when it comes to doing tshuva.
That's how we tshuva is such a heavy load. That's how we, that's what's been.
It's like I'm trying to explain to Ellie for so long that your tshuva is just to stop raising your hand in shir and you can't stop doing it.
It's so hard.
Because
it's part of
me. Yeah, part of your. I just stopped you from doing it this second, right? I'm just messing with you. What do you want to say?
No, so I want to say is the people who are looking for the Gilgulim, I'm going to flip it a little bit.
For the pain and affliction.
No,
yeah.
For them, that's actually easy. They're not going where they need to go.
Right.
I found that when I went to Rav Asher, whatever he gave me, it was just nails. And it wasn't hard to do. It was like every time it was that button. It was the hardest thing in the world for whatever it was. And then I learned that it doesn't have to be what's objectively hard. It's going against your nature. It's breaking. It's being mavir al your nidos,
right,
whatever they are. So if I think that I need to do this to I've got, if I'm drawn towards this to goofing, Dafka don't go there, right? Because that's easy for
I have that.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, that's what I did. Oh, okay.
Right.
I'm cool with that.
Now, you need to do whatever it is that you really, really don't want to do.
Right. Like, in, there were some wrestlers that really, really, really did not want to eat.
Mm-hmm.
So you know what the avoda was?
To eat.
Like, for them, that was the inyan. Mm-hmm. That's the inyan? Yes. Because if every piece of food for them brings them into the olam ha-chomer, then for them, their shorash neshama, eating, not fasting and starving yourself, was the avoda.
So it's to take your what you want and just put it on the side.
Yeah, but how many people are privileged to meet a Rav Asher, right? Like you have. Gale lanu malkeinu, reveal to us, gale lanu malkeinu. I told you one time, Rav Weinberger came to him with all this tzaras, and he gave me what ended up being a very hard etza. Now I understand why. All he did was ask me to pray for his daughter to find the shidduch. Now I think that it became so hard for me to do that because I didn't believe that that could be really the tikkun I needed then, right? When really I afterwards I understood what was he telling me to do. Listen, he said to me, there's nothing as halig as the davening of a tzabrach in a yid. There's nothing holier than the prayer of a broken yid. But we're usually under the assumption, if I'm going to go to a tzaddik, then he's going to prescribe for me, like, you know, learn the cello and play in sevens, or something, you know, musically, that means like rolling around in snow naked, like basically, right? Achen, aval, kfiya amor, en atzadik machmid aleinu klal veklal. But really, it's not the tzadik that is making life heavier for us with his etzas. Kol hakoshi hu ach v'rak mima'ase bal davar. The feeling of what the tzadik says to me as being so heavy, that's just the satan, because he knows if you just listen to the simplicity of the etzah of the tzadik, you're going to the root of your soul, bal, and then he lost it. ומצד החוכמות שגם הם מעט עשה יצא. And then all the chochmas that go into it, should I have gone to him? Should I have not listened to him? All the chochmas started going into your head. והעצה להתגבר על הכל ולקיים את העצות היא רק על ידי קבלת דברי הצדיק ועצותיו בתמימוס ולפשיטוס. Receiving the words of the tzaddik simply with tzmimus and pshitus. Ve'az b'meshech hazman gam ha'kvedut titma'et. And then, over time, that feeling of heaviness over what I need, what the tzaddik told me to do, that'll also start to wear off. U'bevadai yagia lekol atov she'efshar le'agia al yedei ha'tzaddik b'zeh u'vabah. And then really end up tasting all the good that was in the etza, which seemed so easy that eventually it's coming to be brought before you. So, we see over here something, we'll stop here, but we'll see over here that it's important for us to notice when this happens in our life, because I am going to ask all of you on Sunday about your hour from the last 96 hours. And maybe now, because we learned this, we'll have a little bit of an opening to like be like, oh, why is it so hard? Oh, it's because it's root work. I want to do root work. I want to get to the core of my neshama. And if the tzaddik is saying that speaking to Hashem and pouring out your heart to Hashem every single day is much more beneficial and powerful than rolling around in snow and fasting from week to week, I'll take his word for it and just do it. And just do it. So we should be privileged to be around. We should have tzaddikim in our lives. It's a big thing. It's a very big thing. We should have tzaddikim in our lives. We should have the thankfulness to Hashem that He sent towers of light and of guidance into our lives, and to just accept the words that they say to us simply. If they tell us, listen, go and sell your house, get divorced, get remarried, and adopt 4 kids, then you'd be like, wait a second, let me go to the Baal Shem Tov, right? This might be someone else, right? That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the sample etzos, because in Breslov, the Shita is, The sinner of today feels bad enough about what he did. Don't make him feel worse. Don't make it heavier on him. His heart's already open. His heart's broken. And that's why Rabbi Nachman is the doctor of this generation, because that's what we're dealing with. All right. This tzaddik, Rabbi Levi Yitzchak Bender, Zchut Yagen Aleinu. Check him out online a little bit. There's a lot of beautiful stories and stuff about him. I'll try to send a video of him later today.
Yisher
Koch.
Huh? Looking at his watch.
Yes, that one.
The interesting thing about the Yid who went for the second opinion is he didn't go to another branch.
Right.
He went to the source,
right,
which I think is a really important thing to do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.